unto the aversion of everything contrary thereto, the enlightenment, the eyes, of my heart, unto the peace of my spiritual powers, unto faith invincible, unto love unfeigned, unto the filling of wisdom, unto the keeping of thy commandments, and unto growth in thy divine grace, and the attainment of thy kingdom, that by them, preserved in thy holiness, I may ever remember thy grace, and henceforth live not unto myself, but unto thee, our master, benefactor. And thus, when this life is ended, in the hope of eternal life, I may attain unto everlasting rest, for the voice of those whose festival is unceasing, and the delight of those who behold the ineffable beauty of thy countenance is boundless. For thou art the true desire and unutterable joy of all those who love thee, O Christ our God, and all creation cometh thee forever. Amen. May thy holy body, O Lord Jesus Christ our God, be unto me for life eternal, and thy precious blood unto the remission of my sins. May this Eucharist be unto me for joy, health, and gladness, and at thy dread second coming make me a sinner worthy to stand at the right hand of thy glory. The intercessions of the Almighty Mother and of all the saints. Glory to thee, O God. Glory to thee, O God. Glory to thee, O Christ, our God, our hope. Glory to thee. Amen.
This is the day the Lord has made.
Let it be holy.
Please take out one of the Bibles open to page 909. In the 19th chapter of the Gospel of Jesus, as was proclaimed by the holy evangelist St. Luke, verses 3 and 4 read, "And he sought to see Jesus who he was, and could not for the press, because he was little of stature or height. But Talaba and Yara Yeshua Menhua, Ulam Yabdir Mina al Jemni, the Ennuhu Kana Kasira al Karmati, in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. Amen." You know, it's a wonderful blessing to take words and understand their meaning, or verses or sentences. Towards the end of the liturgy, the priest raised the child and says, "Oh Lord, save thy people and bless thy inheritance." The closest Sunday to January 25th, we remember all the modern-day martyrs of Russia. Thousands who gave their life to Christ in the church. And many of these people attended liturgy, I'm sure, because they all did. And they heard the priest say to the monarch, "Oh Lord, save thy people and bless thy inheritance." Not knowing that the calamity was coming. This morning before I came to church, I was asked to go to the hospital. One of our parishioners is gravely ill. Please pray for Dino Orthodox. When you don't come to church every opportunity you have, you never know if that will be your last opportunity. Those people that died in Russia took this literally. So it says that you could not see him for the press because he was short. So we have to ask ourselves, when we don't come to church, when we don't bother to fast, when we don't bother to read our scripture every day, what in our life keeps us from spiritually seeing Jesus? I'm busy, boy. I have a job. I have to take care of the house. I have to take care of the kids. I have to take care of my spouse. I have to mow the lawn. When my youngest son, my oldest son, was young and I asked him to mow the lawn, he kind of grumpily mowed the lawn. After a few times that he came to me, he said, Did you like mowing the lawn in Brooklyn? I never will. He said, "The Lord." I said, "In Brooklyn?" I never saw a Lord in Brooklyn. I said, "We had something more fun to do. In the wintertime, we shoveled snow." He goes, "That's so weird." I said, "Really? How would you like it to be on the lawn if it came back a couple of hours later and had a load all over you? Because that's what the snow did." So my point is that we grumble and we have everything else to do except God. This morning, I got this call this morning, and the family said, "Father, can you come now?" Remind me, when I got out of this, "You know, you reminded me when we were going to have my first child." Then mom, it was Sunday morning, she started to have, you know, indications. I remember I said this, I told you don't have the baby on Sunday. You don't do it on Sunday. Believe it or not, she was very obliging because she didn't have the baby shower that night. But the point I'm bringing out is that we have so many things that we put before God. And that's wrong. Because what is it we have to ask ourselves that keeps us from seeing God? Some people go to divine energy, they never see anything. Nothing. Same thing, same thing, same thing, same thing. I've been blessed to be celebrating divine energy as a priest for over 45 years. I gotta tell you, my friends, every Sunday I see something new. Every Sunday, so just like that about, "Oh Lord, save the people, bless me." Because one, because I'm open to it. I want to see it. I want to experience it. And some people are so busy looking at everything else, they never see Jesus. They're always looking for the solution, but they never see Christ. Because they expect the solution to be more complicated. With God, there's no complications. With God, everything is simple. God takes care of all of it. And the more you become in line with Jesus Christ, the more you realize that. I said that recently to somebody. I said, "Yes, I have a personal relationship with God, with Christ." This is a very Protestant thing. The Protestants said that. I don't remember the Catholics of God saying that I have a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. I mean, the Protestants saying that. And I have a personal, let me tell you what a personal relationship with Jesus Christ is. Personal relationship with Jesus Christ is that Jesus Christ and I are bonded. When I look at the eye of Jesus Christ, I'm bonded. When I think of my life with Jesus Christ, I'm bonded. Recently somebody said to me, "You'll have to answer to God." I said, "For what? What do you want me to answer to God for? For loving God? Oh, mistakes? We all make mistakes. My Lord, if the Lord was going to keep us out of heaven or keep us away from because of mistakes, nobody would get to heaven. Nobody would have an issue with Jesus Christ." I said, "What do you want me to answer to God for? For being loving? For trying to be understanding? For trying to be helpful? Or for something that in your mind you have made this decision that I'm going to have to answer God? I'll answer to God." And when God says to me, "Oh, you shouldn't have done this, you shouldn't have done that, you shouldn't have done that," I'm not going to tell God, I say, "God, you're right, but I tried to be loving. That's my best defense." And one of our prayers says, okay, a good defense before the fearful judgment seat of Christ. That's my defense. I tried to be loving. How many people can say this? You might say, "Well, I can." Well, then I say, "Fine, that's great, you're better than me." Check everything you do. If it's loving, because the reason that we don't see Christ is because we allow all the baloney of this world to block it out. That's why we don't see Jesus. That's why we don't know Jesus. I don't know people sitting here necessarily, but that's why a lot of people don't know Jesus. It goes on, he says, and when they saw it, that he had gone to be the guest with Zacchaeus, they all murmured, saying, there he has gone to be guest with a man that is a sinner. And Zacchaeus stood up and said unto the Lord, "Behold, Lord, the half of my goods I give to the poor, and if I have taken anything from any man by false accusation, I restore to him fourfold." فلما رأوا الجميع ذلك تزامروا قائلين إنه دخل لبيت لأن الرجل خطيئا ووقف زكى وقال للرب ها أنا يا رب وأتي نصف الأموال للمساكين وإن كنت قد وشيت بأحد أردت أربعة أضعفا. How many people in here give half of what they have to the poor? You can keep your hand up, Michelle, because I already know what you're doing. She says, I give half of what I have to the poor. And if I have taken something from somebody wrongfully, I give it back four times. There are people, very wealthy people in America and in the world, that basically rip other people off. And not only don't they give it back, they definitely don't give it back four times over. It's what the scripture, I'm just going by what the Bible says here. Okay, so if we, I remember one time, many years ago. God, I was a teenager, not so many years ago. And I was in a restaurant up in the Pocono Mountains, three or four of my friends. And we got the bill, it was like we had some lunch or something. And the waitress had not included somebody's lunch. So they looked at me and said, hey, guess what she did? She forgot my lunch. No, we got that for free. I said, no, we got to tell the girl. They said, oh, well, who made you Joe Holby? I said, it's not Joe Holby. She's going to get charged for that when they reconcile the checks. She's going to have to pay for that. He says, so what? I said, she doesn't even know you. Did you ask her to pay for your lunch? He said, no. I said, we're going to tell her. Or years ago, do any of you remember, I don't know if you remember this, some of you are not old enough. Now, like I said, I don't know if you're old enough. You know, used to be years ago, you went to get, now put your hand if you remember this. When you went to get gas in your car, there was a guy that worked for the gas station that would pump the gas. Put your hand if you know that, okay? See? You know. But it's true, okay? And sometimes you could go in and say, $2, and the guy forgot, and the thing kept pumping. So you could say, I haven't told you $3, man. No. You knew when you saw it pumping that you was taking something that didn't belong to you. So he says here, I give half of what, so my boy, instead of rejoicing, and this happens all the time, people come to me and say, oh, Father John, how could you be nice to that person because they were so mean to you? Or how could you let that person come to church because they were this or that and the other thing? Going back many years ago, like the 70s, I think the place is still there. I think it's called the Dollhouse. Is it still there? Anybody know? Dollhouse on Orange Blossom Trail. See, I always watch it. If you put your hand up and say, how come you know it's there? You knew better. It was let's say it was a place where women danced without much covering. And it turned out that the owner of the Dollhouse at that time, his people originally were from Syria. And someone came and said, if he gave the church $50,000, what would you do? I say, I would ask him why he gave the church $50,000. If he was repenting, because this guy was not only into owning the Dollhouse, he was also into drug dealing and money laundering. I said, if he repented, thank you very much, but if he wasn't going to repent, I said, we wouldn't be able to take that money. So the point is that some people would sit and complain, oh, why do you have this one, why do you have that? Even more so, when we first started, Rachel remembered this, Gabrielle remembered it, I'm sure a number of you. We first started, you're new, we first started having the homeless meetings here. How many years ago was that, Rachel?
2009.
Hello?
2009.
So we're in the ninth year. And we started having homeless people out here, now they're there all the time. And somebody came to the church one Sunday and said, Father John, I love going to church, but I like seeing all those bums out there. It interferes with my coming to church. You've heard the door, right? I said, you know what? Go take it up with Jesus. Because I'm just doing what Jesus told me to do. You don't like it? Go take it up with Jesus. And they were gone for about 6 months, and they finally came back. So the point is that some people, you don't know the background. These people here, would say, all they know about Zacchaeus was a rich man. So they promised, oh, look, he went to... He said, the man is a sinner. How did they know he was a sinner? They thought he was a sinner because he was a rich man. You don't have to be a sinner and be rich. If you want to be rich, first thing you have to do is have anybody in here, young or old, that wants to be rich, a real simple way to be rich. Work hard and be frugal. Just like gaining weight. Someone came to me recently who was rather large. They said, I don't know how to lose weight. I said, I can tell you how to lose weight. It's so simple. They said, what? I said, there's a great French diet. It's called fermez la bouche. Close your mouth. It is a fact, my friends, that if you take in less food and you exercise, you're going to burn up the food. That's how the body was designed to work. I love when I tell people, oh, I don't want to eat that because I don't want to gain weight. Oh, Father, you don't need to eat. You don't need to lose weight. I say, hello? Why do you think that is? Because I watch what I eat. So the point is that people, instead of murmuring, why is this guy rich? Why does this one have that? Why is that? I will tell you honestly, and you believe it or not, I don't have any jealousy in you. Nada. None. You know why? I remember years ago, many years ago, before I was a priest, obviously, there was a fellow in our